عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We commence as always by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer of one and all. And we send complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon all the messengers whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent down to man from the very beginning right to the very end. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those who struggled and strived in order to protect the deen, to look after it, to convey it in such a way that today it has got to us. May Allah make us from amongst those who can preserve it and realize how fortunate we are to be from amongst the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you take a look at the persecution of the people who had accepted Islam in the early stages, if you ask yourself a question as we did yesterday, why did they accept this faith? Was it because they found wealth there? No. Was it because they found status there? No. Was it because they found something material there? No. Was somebody forcing them? No. Did anyone put a sword at their necks and tell them, believe? No. So they accepted Islam purely out of faith and conviction. Nobody accepted Islam being forced. In fact, those who wanted to accept Islam, in a lot of the cases, thought about it so deeply before they actually accepted, because they knew the type of persecution they were going to face the minute they utter the shahada, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Take a look at Mus'ab ibn Umair radiyallahu anhu. He was from a very, very wealthy family. He was very spoiled by his parents to the degree that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I did not know a person who was more spoilt by his mother than Mus'ab. Mus'ab had clothes which were so well laid. He was dressed very well. He was smelt before he was seen. They knew this man and his itr. So before you could see the man, you would smell him. And he was from a very wealthy family, mashallah, looked after and spoilt. When he heard the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he accepted it. When he accepted it, he kept it quiet so his family doesn't know, from a very powerful family. And one day, one person saw him reading salah, and they went and told his mother, do you know what, this man is fulfilling prayers according to the manner prescribed or taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And immediately, all hell broke loose. She went to him, she spoke to him, she threatened him. He obviously did not deny the fact. So he was grounded to the home. Everything was taken away from him. Nothing spent on him, until there came a time when he did not have proper clothing to wear. And when his skin, after it had been so soft and well looked after, it had started flaking off. And still, to him, that meant nothing. He was so happy that he had had guidance. How many of us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, are ready to sacrifice for our deen? We have it on the plate. No one is holding a sword at our necks, and no one ever holds swords at our necks. We have this on our plate, but still we find it difficult to adopt what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had brought when it comes to some of the smaller items within our lives, or sometimes there are major things within our lives that we refuse to surrender to. For example, the laws of inheritance. Many people, no matter how wealthy they are, they tend to forget about what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said when it comes to the laws of inheritance, the treatment of women, for example. When it comes to various other matters that don't suit us sometimes, we tend to just throw it away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who understand and realize. So this is the example of Mus'ab ibn Umair. If you look at his life, you will find something amazing. He was one of those who took part in the battles. He had gone to Habasha. Habasha is Abyssinia, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed that a little bit later on because of the persecutions. And he took part in the battle of Uhud, and he was martyred in the battle of Uhud to the degree that when he passed away, they were burying him. If they covered his feet, his face was showing. If they covered his face, his feet was showing. He didn't even have enough to cover himself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Then when the verses were revealed, as we had said, فَاصْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرُ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ Proclaim that which you have been instructed, and turn away from the mushriks. These polytheists, turn away from them. Don't fight them. Don't retaliate. So the instruction that Allah gave His messenger was, you proclaim the message, but do not retaliate. If someone attacks you, remain silent. Don't retaliate. Don't respond. Be calm. There was a reason why Allah had said this. In fact, not one reason, but many reasons. The wisdom was Allah's. For us, was just adoption of the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People understand, some people don't understand. Whether you understand or not, success lies in adopting the law and the command. Sometimes with us, we say, why is this the case? It's good to ask, mashallah. But whether then you understand it or not, you must realize what is compulsory will remain compulsory. What is prohibited will remain prohibited, whether you understand it or not. Subhanallah. Because with our small brains and minds, sometimes we would not understand the bigger picture. And we won't understand the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He instructs something. So Allah says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, proclaim the message and don't retaliate, don't respond. So now Quraysh was called and they were given the message. They were told one by one. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam began attending the festivals of the kuffar. He would go to the Kaaba, and there they had a habit of people making tawaf naked, men and women, absolutely naked, because foolishly they would promise their gods that if this happens to us, we will do this. And if we do this, we want that to happen to us, and so on. So what would happen? They would go around the Kaaba naked. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go there and he would look down and say, Ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. O people, say there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, besides the Maker, the one who made you. Whoever made you, he is the only one worthy of worship. Whoever you are going to return to, he is the only one worthy of worship. Utter those words and you will succeed. Subhanallah. And he continued saying that. He was not bothered or interested in how they were dressed or not dressed. He wanted the message to get to them as per the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not intermingle. Obviously, he did not intermingle. They were naked. He looked down and he continued delivering the message. But the fact that they were naked did not stop him from delivering the message. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding when it comes to delivering the message. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us learn a lesson from what had happened at that time. So here, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced persecution of Quraysh. They wanted to beat him up. You've got the audacity to come in our own midst, our territory, and you want to come and talk about our gods and our idols. And he did not used to swear the idols, not at all. But all he used to do is say, these idols will not harm, they will not benefit. You know, if you look at one of the slave girls, her name was Zinnira. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her, radiyallahu anha. She accepted Islam, she was a slave girl, and Abu Jahl and the likes began to punish her. They punished her, they beat her up, because obviously she was a Roman girl, Allahu Akbar, had come from the Roman Empire, she was enslaved. And when they beat her up so much, she continued reiterating that she believes in one God, not in Lat wal Uzza. Lat wal Uzza were names of these idols. And they beat her so much that she went blind. And what had happened is, they started mocking until Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu came forth with some wealth and he purchased her and he freed her for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when she was leaving, they started commenting. They said, it is Lat and Uzza through whom your sight has been taken away, because you went against our idols, the idols have taken away your sight. At that juncture, she said, Wallahi, Al-Lat and Al-Uzza, they can neither harm nor benefit, neither me nor themselves. My eyesight went because of Allah's decision, and He is the one who will return it to me. As she said that, do you know what happened? Her eyesight was restored. Miracle happened in the midst of Quraysh. Subhanallah. They were gobsmacked, but it still did not bat their eyelids. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Zinnira radiallahu anha a lofty rank in Jannah. She indeed went through a lot, and her eyesight was restored miraculously. So Quraysh, they began to plan and plot against the Muslims. They were harming them. They didn't want to do business with them. And at the same time, they began swearing, mocking. Wherever they could, they would beat up people one by one. Next thing you hear, that one was beaten up. That one was beaten up. All across, there was chaos in the sense that although they could not openly fight because of each person's family members, you see their hearts amongst the family members, there were two or three staunch enemies. And then you would have a few people whose hearts are softened, and you would have a few Muslims. So the families were made up of various types of people. It was impossible for them to beat up people whose family members were ready to stand up for them, even though they had not been Muslims. But because of the bond and the link of blood. So with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Jahl, he had a lot of incidents where he came forth to harm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at that stage, remember, they still used to ask a few questions. They used to still talk to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and say, okay, tell your God this and tell your God that, and we want to know this and we want to know that. There were four main things that the kuffar of Quraysh had denied or they were finding fault in. The first was the issue of wahdaniyya. Wahdaniyya meaning tawheed, the oneness of Allah. How can we worship one God when we've been worshipping so many gods all along? And this is why they began to call him mad. أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. Has he made all the gods into one God? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not make the gods into one God. No. He told them all these gods will neither help nor harm. You need to worship whoever made you. What was so wrong about that message? You need to worship whoever you are going to return to. The owner of heaven and hell, you worship him alone. The one whom you are answerable to, that is the only one you shall worship. That is Islam. And this is what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called them towards. We know the term Allah was used by them as well, because Allah means the worshipped one. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they did not deny that they were created by one supreme deity, but at the same time they refused to worship him alone. They only worshipped him when they were in serious trouble. So now Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being faced with questions about tawheed, in fact the oneness of Allah was something they continued raising. If you look at some of the questions that they had asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they told him, Sahirun kathab, you are a magician and you are a liar. Where is he a liar from? What did he lie about? He is just telling them, look, this won't harm and it won't help. So it cannot harm or help itself. Why do you call me a liar? I'm giving you information. Go and try it, test it, see. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. They went on a smear campaign, character assassination, or what we can call a media campaign. On its own level at that particular time, they went around Quraysh saying this man is possessed. It's confirmed that he's a madman. The doctors have come in, all the experts have come in. They've confirmed this man is possessed. He's a madman. Or they continue to say he is a fortune teller. You see, he's coming to say things of the future. And then they also said he's a very, very eloquent poet. But what he came with was not poetry. They also said he's mad, possessed, and he has within him a jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. They then said someone has done magic on him. And at one stage they even said he's a magician himself, because the magicians, they separate between husband and wife. And all these accusations amounted to nothing when it came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Inna kafaynaka al-mustahzi'een. We have protected you against those who mock about you. So they can mock, it will be to their detriment, not to yours. Up to today, that verse is valid. Those who want to mock at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they want to draw cartoons about him. They want to make images and they want to try and make fools of what the messenger's message was and so on. Allah says, don't worry. We have protected you from that. You are far higher than all they can do when it comes to mocking. And it will be against them. Did you realize that when the cartoons were drawn lately, It resulted in great exposure for Islam and the Muslims, and so many people turned to Islam. For the first time in their lives, they found out that it is a religion of purity, the purest of all religions, and they began to turn. Had it not been for those cartoons, they probably would have still been lying in their ignorance. So, as we say, رُبَّ ضَارَّةٍ نَافِعَةٍ. Sometimes something appears negative, but there is a lot of positivity that comes out of that negative. Another question they asked, the second thing that they asked about life after death. How can you tell us that after we are going to be dust, we're going to be resurrected? As you know, in Surah Yasin as well, the question they used to ask, مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ. Who is going to give life to these bones after they are dispersed, completely decomposed and scattered? And Allah responds by saying, قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ. Say to them, He will give them life who gave them life in the first place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us the day He resurrects us. And may we be from amongst those who are conscious on our day-to-day lives as to our deeds, so that we can face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through His mercy we can attain Jannah and paradise. They also, the third thing that they found fault in was the messenger himself. Who are you? You were an orphan. You were brought up an orphan. You didn't even have a father. And later on your mother also died. And who are you? How can you have been chosen by Allah?
وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ.
They said, why wasn't this Quran revealed to a very, very powerful man, either from Makkah or from Ta'if? Why did it have to be you who is so weak from amongst us? So Allah says, we chose whom we want to give the message to. Allahu Akbar. It doesn't mean that you have the choice and decision. And then they began to say, well, why isn't there an angel?
وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ.
Why doesn't he have an angel with him? If he's really a messenger, he must bring an angel. The angel must talk to us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds, and Allah says, Subhanallah.
وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ.
Allahu Akbar. The question was, why didn't an angel come? And Allah says,
وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا.
Had we sent an angel, we would have brought him in the form of a man. And the verse just before that, or part of the verse, says that had we sent an angel down, لَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ ثُمَّ لَا يُنظَرُونَ. The matter between them would have been immediately judged, decided. The punishment would have come automatically. When you ask for a sign, and the sign comes, and then you disbelieve, you're asking for disaster. Subhanallah. So, it was Allah's mercy that He did not send the angel in person, because Allah says, had we sent it as you wanted it, we would have then sent the punishment together with it for anyone who disbelieved thereafter. And so many other points that they raised against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of them was,
مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقُ.
Why is this prophet, who is claiming to be a prophet, walking in the marketplaces and eating food like all of us? He should be someone who has an angel doing his errands for him. And Allah says in response to that,
وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا إِنَّهُمْ لَيَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَسْوَاقُ.
Every messenger that we sent before him, every one of them walked in the marketplaces and ate food. Subhanallah. So he is no different. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So many things they raised. The fourth point that they raised was regarding the Quran itself. That this Quran, why is it coming down in drips and drabs? Why is it coming down verse by verse? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds. Do you know what they said? Subhanallah.
لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدَةً كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا.
They questioned, why doesn't this Quran, why didn't it come down all at once like the Torah? Musa alayhi salam, the Prophet Moses went, he collected the book, he came back. So why didn't this book come down just like that? And Allah says, because Allah wanted it to strengthen your heart. It came down bit by bit. When an incident occurred, a verse would be revealed. So nobody would forget it. To this day, we have verses, inshallah, this evening we are going to look into some of them, where something happened and verses were revealed. And immediately, the problem was solved. Not only that, the verse was remembered with a story. If I were to tell you a story, it is far easier for you to remember the moral of it than if I were to just recite rules and regulations for you. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. So they had raised also, they raised a point regarding the same Quran.
أساطير الأولين اكتتبها فهي تملى عليه بكرة وأصيلا.
These are tales of the past that have been dictated to him by night and by day. So he checked them, he saw them, and he noted them down and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says elsewhere in the Quran,
وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِن قَبْلِهِ مِن كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ.
You never read a book. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you never could read a book. Never. Before the Quran came, you could never read a book, nor could you write. Had that been the case, maybe then they could have doubted that you got it from others. But neither could you read nor write. You've never read a book, nor have you written anything. So how then can they come up with these accusations? Subhanallah. So everything went back into their faces. Subhanallah. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenges them. What does Allah say? Allah says, قُلْ, tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, challenge them.
لَإِنْ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا.
If all mankind and jinnkind had to get together and help one another to come up with something similar to the Quran, they would never ever come up with it. Challenge number one. So they obviously surrendered to the challenge because they knew that this is not going to happen. So Allah says, let's make it easier for you.
أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ.
Are they saying that this is fabricated?
قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ.
Tell them, bring about 10 surahs similar to it. 10 chapters similar to it. And then let's see what happens. Still, they couldn't do anything. Then Allah says, okay, we make it easier.
Allahu Akbar. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ.
Let them come up with one surah similar to it. Still, the challenge was not met. Then there was the challenge right up to the end of time. What was the challenge?
فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِّثْلِهِ إِن كَانُوا صَادِقِينَ.
Let them come up with anything similar to it if they are truthful. Even if it means a phrase, a few words, let them bring it. They will find always the Quran will be higher. They tried and they said a few things which had no meaning. And at the same time, they were concentrating more on the rhyming. Whereas the Quran, not all the verses rhyme. Did you know that the verses that rhyme all at once, they are connected to one topic. The minute the rhyming changes, the topic has changed. That's the power of the Quran. Amazing. And most of these verses that were short and sharp were revealed in Makkatul Mukarrama. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to read Salah. It is reported that Abu Jahl, Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq and Abu Sufyan, these people had got up at night separately. And they went to where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reciting the Quran in Salah. And they went to hear him. Listen. So neither of them, or not a single one of them, knew that the other one was also there, but they were hiding in the dark, listening. Oh, they enjoy the recitation. Beautiful meaning, powerful words, Allahu Akbar. And as they were going back, they bumped into each other. What are you doing here? The other one says, what are you doing here? Then the third one says, what are both of you doing here? Well, what are all three of us doing here? Well, they had to own up, isn't it? We came to listen to these words. Don't you dare come back. Let's promise. Okay, we promise. Next day, same thing happened. Allahu Akbar. Why?
The Quran has a pull. If you have sincerity in your heart, even to the smallest degree, even the kuffar, to be honest, there are findings today that people have experimented where when you play the Quran melodiously to a baby, you find the way the baby reacts to it in a very calm way, the same reaction happens with adults. When you play the Quran for them, the melody of that Quran is such that it soothes the hearts and it calms the people, because this is the word of the creator of the same people. So these three, second day, same thing happened. Third day, they had to swear big oaths to say we're never ever going to come back again. And after that, they didn't come back. But that itself is evidence enough. Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu later on makes mention of this. And he says, this is what happened. We are telling you, this is what happened. Allahu Akbar. They knew it. They knew that it's the truth. This is why Allah revealed verses to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says,
قَدْ نَعْلَمُ إِنَّهُ لَيَحْزُنُكَ الَّذِي يَقُولُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ.
We know that their utterances and accusations and whatever they are saying by their mouths is hurting you. We know that it makes you sad what they utter. They're uttering so many things, spreading rumor. But we want you to know, they do not belie you. They are denying out of arrogance. That's what it is. Deep down in their hearts, they know what is right and what is wrong. But they are denying out of arrogance. That verse comforted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a lot, because his duty was to deliver the message. And then he realized the message is being delivered, but it's the arrogance. This is why we believe, مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْهُ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. Whomsoever Allah has guided, they shall be guided. And whomsoever Allah has not written guidance for, there is no chance that they will be guided. Because guidance is not written for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us at all times, and may He make us steadfast. So these were the challenges that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given the people of Quraysh. Come up with a little portion similar to the Quran. They couldn't do that. I was speaking earlier about Abu Jahl. He had taken a boulder once after having spoken to the chiefs of Quraysh in the early days, just after the call became open and apparent. And he said, I am going to kill this young man, and then Banu Hashim and those people, his clan and his family, can do what they want to me. I just want to sort the problem out, because we're going to lose our power here. We are powerful people leading Quraysh, and we are calling towards these idols. Every year the Arabs are coming around and they are worshipping the idols, and we are going to lose this power because he is calling us to leave everything that we're doing at this moment in time. All this worship is a waste of time, he is saying. Worship your maker and none other than your maker. So if that's the case, we're going to lose. What should we do? Well, I'm going to sort him out. So he decided the following day, he took the boulder. Whilst Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in sajda, he was about to throw that boulder on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from a little bit of a height. And suddenly he stopped and he turned around. He went back, he put the boulder down, and the people of Quraysh who were watching him started laughing at him. Hey, what happened here? You, the big man of Quraysh here, Abu Jahl, and now what has happened here? He says, you know, when I got near him, I suddenly saw a massive camel, huge camel, come in my direction, and it wanted to eat me up. Allahu Akbar, a big man. He was so worried, so scared. He started seeing this camel. And he says, I quickly turned around, I put the boulder down and I carried on. Wallahi, doesn't that sound like a little baby? Allahu Akbar. This was Allah protecting his messenger. This was Allah. This has happened twice to Abu Jahl. The once he had oppressed a man. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there. The people of Quraysh told this man, if Abu Jahl owes you money, there's only one way you're going to get it. And they said this jokingly. They wanted to make a mockery of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he talks to Abu Jahl, you'll get your money back. Now that was a mockery, because they knew these two, obviously nobody is going to listen to the other here. So when this man went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, come, let's go. He went to Abu Jahl, knocked on his door. Abu Jahl opened the door. And when he opened the door, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "You owe this man some money." He says, "Yes, I do." And he gave the man his money, and the problem was solved. So the people of Quraysh, they got to hear about it. The leaders said, "Abu Jahl, what happened?" The same thing happened. He says, "When the knock on the door happened, I got frightened. I came to the door and I was so scared. And when I came there, I saw these two people. I was asked for the wealth. And as I was about to answer, I saw the same camel come in my direction." Allahu Akbar. That was the punishment of Allah to Abu Jahl. And that was also showing Quraysh that don't make a mockery of this messenger. We have protected him against all mocking. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So that was Abu Jahl, and this is what he had done. Also, if you look at verses of the Quran, you see the first surah, the first verses that were revealed were Iqra. We know that. If you look further down that surah, you will find certain verses relating to Abu Jahl. If you pick up the English translation and read those verses, you will find something very interesting. Abu Jahl, every time he saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying, he would go and stop him. And he would physically try and chase him away. So what had happened? Allah revealed verses. And these verses were directed to Abu Jahl and mentioning his story.
أرأيت الذي ينهى عبدا إذا صلى أرأيت إن كان على الهدى أو أمر بالتقوى أرأيت إن كذب وتولى ألم يعلم بأن الله يرى.
Right to the end of that surah, the verses meaning, do you see the one who stops the worshipper from praying? Do you see the one who is stopping the worshipper from praying? Does he not see? What if he is on the right path? What if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is correct? Then what is this man going to do? And what if this man here is totally wrong? What's going to happen? So why stop a man who is praying to the Almighty? For what? Why stop him? And these verses admonished Abu Jahl and warned him of a severe punishment, to say, you can do what you want, you can call all your helpers, but on that day we will call the gatekeepers of hell and they will take you. They will take you from your forelock. You read those verses, very powerful verses in the same surah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Another man, Abu Lahab. And we need to know these names, the names of the enemies, just like we knew the names, or we learned the names of those who had accepted Islam in the early days, we will also know who were those who harmed Islam and who harmed the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Abu Lahab was his uncle, and he was also a neighbor, and every day he used to throw out his rubbish and dirt at the door of his neighbor Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to come out and see all the dirt and all the bin, literally, of Abu Lahab at his doorstep, and he would take it away and he would continue saying, "Ayu jiwarin hada?" What kind of a neighbor is this? Up to today, we as Muslims are not allowed to do anything that would harm our neighbor, whether he is a Muslim or not. We are not allowed to do anything, so much so that if you want to light a fire or a smoke, make sure that the smoke does not affect them negatively. Ensure that. Otherwise, we cannot call ourselves true followers of this message. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Some people, astaghfirullah, they disturb the neighbor with so much noise every single day. And the neighbors, if they're not Muslim, or if they're Muslim, did you know they have a right for you to ensure the peace and the calm within their home? They must not be harmed from your noise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So Abu Lahab, he was one of those who did that. And you know, his wife Ummu Jamil was also a culprit. She used to also throw defecation at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, literally. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about her in Surah Lahab, as we heard yesterday. May Allah safeguard us. These people did nothing good for themselves, because one is to keep quiet and to carry on with whatever you're doing, but the other is to get up and harm the man. Harm the man. If you are going to harm him, you will really pay for it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Today, what happens in our societies, we hear of something and we don't even know this man serves the cause of Allah. He has dedicated his life to serve the deen of Allah. And what we do? We spread rumor about him. We spread gossip about him. We make his life difficult. We cause this and cause that. What will happen as a result? Do we not think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deal with us? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He make us from those who are worried about ourselves and our deeds. And we are worried about our link with our Maker. And if we are worried about others, we are meant to be worried about our brothers and sisters across the globe who are suffering. And if we can, we should do something positive about it, but we should never engage in something negative. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. A very dangerous man, his name was Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt. This man, when Abu Jahl called out one day, and he said, I have the defecation of these camels. Who is going to throw it on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he is in sajda? Imagine, when he is in sajda. And Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt got up, he picked up this thing here, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in sajda, and literally the defecation of the camel, a'udhu billah, Allah safeguard us, he threw it onto the back of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he remained in sajda. The Muslims at the time were weak, nobody could go to remove it. Do you know what happened? His little daughter Fatima radiallahu anha, small little girl, what she did, she saw her father in this condition of sujood, and she saw that he's got all this on his back. These people of Makkah have really harassed him. They have thrown this. So she went and she took it off his back. And she actually wiped it out completely. And then he got up from sajda. And this is what Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth did. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam got up, he says, Allahumma alayka bi fulanin wa fulan. Oh Allah, I hand so and so over to you. I hand so and so over to you. And he mentioned names. Imagine, for the messenger to make a dua. Oh Allah, I'm handing them over to you. Alayka bihim. Ya Allah, you deal with them. What a powerful way of making dua. And he was executed after the battle of Badr. He was one of those who was taken captive and executed. And together with him was a friend of his as well, who also harassed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam a lot by the name of An-Nadr ibn al-Harith. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to safeguard us from the dua of his friends against us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us at all times. So this Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth, this was one of the ways that he had hassled Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was also a neighbor of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day he invited Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his home with the people of Quraysh. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go whenever Quraysh invited him, because he would feel maybe they might listen to me. Maybe they might listen to a word or two and come onto the right path. So when Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth invited him, he went and he entered the house and he says, Ya Uqbah, do you know what? I'm not going to eat your food until you bear witness that there is none worthy of worship but Allah and that I am the messenger of Allah. So Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth looked at him and said, I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship but Allah. And I bear witness that you are a messenger. So the people of Quraysh later on, they said, what did you say? Did we hear you say that you bear witness? He said, no, I had a guest in my house who refused to eat until I said a few words. So I said them, A'udhu Billah. That was the worst statement he could have ever uttered. Because there were others who were weak and downtrodden in Makkah. They never cheated in that way. When they uttered it powerfully with sincerity. This man was wealthy. He had nothing to lose whether he said it or not. He could have told him, hey, you can carry on. But he didn't do that. He decided to cheat. And because of that, he paid a heavy price. One day he was so upset. He came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was one of the worst things that have happened in Makkah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He took a piece of cloth, this Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayth, and he strangled Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he kept pulling this cloth. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was choking. And the only person who had rushed to his help was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And he rushed and he wrestled this Uqbah and released Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from that stranglehold. And he said, أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَن يَقُولَ رَبِّيَ اللَّهِ وَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. How can you kill a man who is saying, my Lord is Allah. And he has brought you clear-cut signs and you want to kill him. Leave him alone at least. Allahu Akbar. This was that Uqbah. Another man who really harassed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Al-As ibn Wa'il. He was a man who constantly used to pass and laugh and joke. He used to say, these people believe in life after death. They say there's going to be heaven and everybody's going to get so many nice things, and there's going to be hell and there's going to be this and that. So every time he used to pass, he used to joke about it. And he used to say,
مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهْ.
Those verses were revealed, saying the statement that this man Al-As ibn Wa'il used to utter, and the people of Quraysh. They used to say, oh, we are only going to live in this life, and there is no life after death. Whatever will kill us, or what will actually kill us, is time. It's only time that makes us old, and we will die. We're not going to be resurrected. And Allah says, Inhum illa yadhunnun. Those are their doubts. What do they know? But this man crossed a certain limit. What was that limit? He was owed money by Khabbab ibn al-Arat. In fact, he owed money to Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiyallahu anhu. Al-As ibn Wa'il owed money to Khabbab ibn al-Arat, who was a Muslim. And Khabbab ibn al-Arat, every time he went to him, this man used to duck and dive, because now the Muslims, nobody's going to come and say, hey, where's this man's money? So one day Khabbab ibn al-Arat had got hold of a few people, and they went to this man and told him, look, you know, you need to give him his money. So Al-As ibn Wa'il says, isn't he one of those who believes that there's going to be heaven and there's going to be lots of goodness, and in heaven you get whatever you want and so on? So Khabbab says, yes, indeed, I believe that. There will be heaven and we get what we want there. So he says, so give me a little bit of time. When we get to heaven and I get whatever I want, then I'll pay you your money. Now look at how foolish he is. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses exposing this man.
أَفَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي كَفَرَ بِآيَاتِنَا وَقَالَ لَأُوتَيَنَّ مَالًا وَوَلَدًا.
Do you see this man who has disbelieved in our signs, and he is saying that I am going to be given lots of wealth and lots of children in paradise? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks a question, does he even think he's going to go to paradise? And does he even know whether he is going to get anything or not? Subhanallah. How can he come and utter that, okay, I'm going to go to paradise, when he disbelieves in it? So this was also exposing this man, Al-As ibn Wa'il, when it came to him and the money that he owed Khabbab ibn al-Arat radiyallahu anhu. Remember, every time these bad things happened, it drifted the people who did them further and further away from the message. Look at the others who had harmed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Aswad ibn al-Muttalib, this was a cousin of Khadija radiyallahu anhu. And he used to laugh at the Muslims. And the verses in Surah Al-Mutaffifin were revealed regarding this man.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَجْرَمُوا كَانُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَضْحَكُونَ.
The criminals used to laugh at those who believe. Up to today, you want to grow your beard according to the teachings of all the messengers, whether it is Jesus, peace be upon him, Moses, peace be upon him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or all the other messengers, every single one of them grew facial hair. So if you'd like to grow it, you find people making a mockery out of you. They laugh. You find women who want to cover and dress according to the dress code of the Muslims. In fact, it goes back further than that. Even Mary, Maryam, alayha salatu wasalam, may peace be upon her, the mother of Jesus, may peace be upon her. What type of clothing did she wear? We do not draw images of her, but the Christians who draw images of her, have they ever drawn images of her with a jeans or a t-shirt or a hipster? No, they drew her images exactly how the Muslim women dress today, subhanallah. But we are considered people who are backward because we want to follow the mother of Jesus, may peace be upon her, in her dress code. Allahu Akbar. Look at how the world has gone upside down. We want to follow Jesus, may peace be upon him, in his looks. Have you ever seen them? We don't draw images, as you know. Have you seen them draw images of Jesus, may peace be upon him, in a suit and a tie, clean shaven? Not one, never. So when we want to wear our robes and grow our beards, they tell us these people are like this and these people are like that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. And may he guide us as well. So this man used to laugh. These verses in Surah Al-Mutaffifin were revealed about him. And Allah says,
فَالْيَوْمَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ يَضْحَكُونَ.
On this day, the believers will be given the opportunity to laugh at those who laughed at them from amongst the disbelievers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and grant us goodness. There was another man known as Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. He was the uncle of Abu Jahl. He also had a lot to do in terms of harm against the Muslims. He went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he heard verses of the Quran. He came back to his people and he told his people, I have heard the Quran. And you know what? It is very powerful. It is not the speech of an ordinary man, nor is it the speech of a fortune teller, nor is it the speech of a poet, nor is it the speech of a madman. No, it has a sweetness in it and it will have some form of rank in the very near future because it's very powerful. And the people of Quraysh were shocked because he was the uncle of Abu Jahl and he was one of the leaders. They said, are you senile? This man has now gone mad. Abu Jahl decided to go to him and spoke to him and began to weep and tell him, how can you say this? Come on, a man like you, we look up to you. We can't lose you. We cannot lose you to this type of thing. And so he got up and he walked to the rest of Quraysh and he says, do you ever think Muhammad was mad? He was never mad. And there is no sign of madness in him. They were watching him. Does he look like he's a fortune teller? He's not a fortune teller. They were watching him. They shocked. Does he look like a person who is a magician? Does he look like he's a person who is this and that? So many things. And thereafter, when all of them were looking at him quite shocked, he then says, well, I think we'd rather just call him a magician because it's magicians who separate between husband and wife and family members, and that's what he has done. So they all started laughing. Look at how he almost accepted the message, but because of his colleagues and his dignity in society, he did not want to accept the message. This was Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. An-Nadr ibn al-Harith, he used to always say, I have better speech than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Come listen to me. When the Quran was being read, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَالْغَوْا فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَغْلِبُونَ. They used to say, whilst the Quran was being read, make a lot of noise. Don't listen. Make a lot of noise. Because if you want to overpower Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't listen to his message. Why did they say that? The minute people heard the message, they turned. They heard a verse, they turned. They heard five verses, they turned. So they had one option, make a noise, ban him, don't allow him to read, stop it, we don't want to hear these words. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is what they uttered. This man used to say, no, 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 come to me, I will give you better stories. And he knew a few stories of the Persian Empire. So he used to come and make mention of this Persian leader and that Persian leader, which was nothing like the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him elevation, although they were persecuted to a great degree. Allah blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with an uncle. An uncle who was never a Muslim, but he was just. And he had a feeling for his nephew. And this is why they could not kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Abu Talib, who was one of the leaders of Quraysh, powerful leader, when Abu Jahl and them planned to harm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told them, you dare touch him. If you do, war will break out. So now they knew, we cannot touch the man. And this is why Allah had protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the same applies to others who had family. They were protected because they had family members who always stood by them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had granted this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this uncle who did not accept the message. Quraysh went to the uncle and told him, talk to your nephew, tell him to stop. So when he went to the nephew, he said, look, you know, you're putting me in a spot here. Quraysh, we know we have got good dealings with them. We are related. And you know, now you have come with what you have come with. Why don't you stop saying all this? Because it's about time you stopped. He told his uncle, wallahi, if you were to put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand and instruct me to stop what I am doing, I will not stop it. I am asking them to leave their idols. What's wrong? This was the persecution. So his uncle looked at him and said, "Oh, my nephew, carry on. Don't worry. Carry on. You are safe." Imagine. Meaning deep down, he knew what was right. He knew what was right. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had then, meaning blessed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam much more. He had respect in Quraysh, but at the same time, hatred. They were forced to respect him, but deep down, they hated him. In fact, what they did, and this is a very interesting story. They got together and they decided, let's send a man from amongst us, an eloquent man. This eloquent man, we will send him and he will go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and address him, ask him questions and offer him whatever he wants. Because they now noticed Islam was growing and it was becoming strong. Nearly every powerful family had some members in it who were Muslim. So Utba ibn Rabi'ah was a man who decided, okay, I'm going to go. He went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, "Oh, you're a relative of ours. You know, we know your status, very high standing and so on. And we'd like you to understand that we don't want to be at war, loggerheads. What do you want? You want wealth? We give you wealth. You want position? We make you our leader. You want women? You can marry whom you want. You want authority? We make you the leader and you can be in authority. What is it that you want? You name what you'd like, we give it to you." And he continued to say, "But just stop talking about these idols and stop talking about this condition of ours. We're enjoying life." Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, "Are you done?" He says, "Yes. Now listen to me." And he began reading verses, the opening verses of Surah Fussilat, also known as Hamim al-Sajda.
Hamim tanzilum minar rahmanir rahim kitabun fussilat ayatuhu qur'anan arabiyya liqaumin ya'lamuna bashiran wa nadhira.
This man was shocked, gobsmacked, listening to these verses, powerful verses. Let us go home inshallah this evening and look up Surah Fussilat and check the meanings of the first verses of the surah until the verse where the punishment of Ad and Thamud is made mention of. And we will see when the Prophet, peace be upon him, got to the verse saying, if they turn away, warn them of the similar punishment that had struck Ad and Thamud before them. Utba ibn Rabi'ah took his hand and covered the mouth of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, "Stop, I don't even want to hear." And thereafter he went back to Quraysh and told them, "I have heard a word and I'm telling you this word is going to overpower us completely." And they looked at him, "But we sent you to go and tell the man something. You're coming back telling us something else." He says, No, I'm not accepting it, but I just want to let you know, in my view, this word is extremely powerful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand that if the enemies can confirm that the word is powerful, what about us who are Muslims? Have we read it yet? This is why I say this evening, inshallah, let us go back home. And let us look at the verses of Surah Fussilat, also known as Hamim al-Sajda. And let us read the meanings and see what was said to this man, Utba ibn Rabi'ah, that moved him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala move us until we meet again. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdih. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayhi.